this. He said, but you love us. And where is the love? You say you love us. Allow us. Give us permission to sin. Give us permission to offer polluted things. Don't you? Give us permission to offer contemptible things to you. After all, you love us. You love us. You love us. And God said, now, his son will honor the father. The father should love the son, but the son should also show affection to the father. And a master will love the subject or the servant, but the servant must also reciprocate. And then he says the governor must love the subject, and the subject too must show loyalty and obedience and responsibility in the citizens of the community. And so he said, but if I am father, where is my honor? If I am master, where is my honor? If I am governor, where is my honor? He said, okay, now, the children of Israel, the people of Judah, and those who belong to Jacob, Israel, offer this to your governor. Will he accept that from you? That's what the Lord was saying. He condemned, polluted, contemptible, corrupted sacrifices for him. Number one, God is father. He wanted them to understand that. Number two, God is master. He wanted them to know that. Number three, God is governor. As God is father, he wants affection, because this is now a family, and he wants relationship. That's a family. As God is master, he wants responsibility. That the servant to the master must show that I'm responsible. I have obligation. This is what I need to do as the subject to the governor. First, the son to the father. Second, the servant to the master. And third, the subject to the governor. There must be royalty because he is governor. And there must be responsibility because he is master. And there must be relationship because he is father. You know, some people think only the New Testament addressed God as father. But no, the people of Israel, those people belonging to Jacob, they understood that God was their father. And that's what God was reiterating and repeating unto them. I am father, I am father, and therefore I demand honor. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32, and we're reading here from verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 32, and we're reading from verse 6 to show that God is father. And if there is father, there must be the affection between the son and the father. There must be the relationship that shows that this is father. It says in chapter 32, verse 6, do ye thus requite the Lord, O foolish people and unwise? Is he not thy father that bought thee? And has he not made thee and established thee? Is he not thy father? Are you going to relate with him like this? Are you going to offer something like this to him that is polluted and corrupted and contemptible? Not only that, his master. Didn't Jesus Christ emphasize that fact to his own disciples when he said that he was and still is the Lord and master? In John chapter 13, John chapter 13, emphasizing the fact that God is master and Jesus Christ is our Lord and master. And if you say Jesus loves you, understand that he loves you to make you a child of God. There must be that good relationship, and you must have that affection and love towards the Lord. And he loves you to make you his own servant. That he is master and he is Lord. Look at chapter 13, verse 13. He called me master and Lord. And you say, well, for so I am. For so I am. He is our master and God is our father. In Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. We're reading here from verse 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 6. Not with eye service, as men please us, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. You know the demand of God. And you know how you need to respond to the love of God. Because he is master. Because he is Lord. Because he is Savior. Because he gave everything for you. Said, it will not be with high service. He said in verse 7, with good will, doing service as to the Lord and not unto men. It says you do this as to the Lord, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And then you love God with all your heart, love God with all your soul, love God with all your mind, that you may live. It says in verse 8, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether it be he be bond or free. And ye masters, do the same things unto them, forbearing, threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven. Knowing that your master also is in heaven. And then you come now to Malachi, and he says, I am a father. Yes, he is. I am your master. Yes, he is. But then he also says his governor. He says, can you offer that to your governor? Let's look at God being the governor. He tells us in Psalm 22. Psalm 22 talks about God. It talks about our Lord Jesus Christ. As you look at this, Psalm 22, if you start from verse 1, you begin to see the prophecy concerning the cross. Concerning Calvary, concerning Christ's crucifixion, it says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring, of my groaning, and the words of my cry? That tells you, that's the cross right there. Look at verse 7. In verse 7, it says, all day that see me love me to scorn, and they shoot out the leaf, they shake the head, saying, he trusted on the Lord that he will deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. He's talking about Christ on the cross of Calvary. When those people were making jest of him, he says, he saved others, himself he cannot save. Let now the King of the Jews come down from the cross, and we will believe him. Look at verse 15. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to the to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. It says, for dogs, in verse 16, have compassed me, and the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hand, they pierced my feet. It's talking about Christ. But now, come to verse 27. Verse 27 and verse 28, it says, all the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all the kindreds of nations shall worship before thee, for the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the, tell me what's there? Is a governor among the nations. Is a governor. Three things about our God, three things about our Lord. Number one, Father. Number two, is Master. Number three is governor. Come back now to Malachi chapter 1. And the controversy that the Lord had with the children of Israel is this. It says in verse 6, chapter 1, his son honoreth his father, and his servant his master. And if I be a father, and he is, where is mine honor? He said, how are you honoring me? I'm your father. And every time you pray, you have been taught to pray, our Father which art in heaven. And then he says, for your heavenly Father knows that he have need of these things. He says, it's your Father. And because it's your Father, what honor are you giving unto him? And then he says, if I be a master, where is my fear? If I be a master, where is the loyalty? Where is the responsibility? And where is the obligation? And where is the obedience you are granting unto me? He says, O ye priests that despise my name, and you say, wherein have we despised your name? It says, she offered polluted bread upon mine altar. And you say, wherein have we polluted thee, in that he say, the table of the Lord is contemptible. Look at verse 8. And if ye offer the blind for the sacrifice, is it not evil? If ye offer the lame and the sick, is it not evil? Offer that now unto thy governor, will he be pleased with thee? Offer that to your governor, will he be pleased with ye? If I'm father, if I am master, if I am a governor, what are you offering to me? That's what he said. He was telling them that they were doing evil. Why? Because they were not giving the best to God. They expected God to give them his best. They expected God to give them great, great blessing. But on the other hand, they were not responding. They were not reciprocating. They were not reflecting that love of God. God has given us the best already. He's giving us Jesus Christ. He's giving us salvation. He's giving us sanctification. He's giving us the power of the Holy Ghost. He's giving us promises. He's giving us great things. He's even going to provide heaven for us. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. He said, how are you then returning that favor back to God? In their own case, they were not offering the best, they were offering the worst. They were not offering the first, they were offering the leftovers. That is, they'll take care of themselves first, they'll provide for themselves first, they'll take the very best for themselves, and then the blind and the lame and the refuse and the useless, they'll offer that unto God. And God said, that's not acceptable. And he doesn't need to quote many verses of scripture to tell them it was not acceptable. He said, just simply offer that to your governor. Let's offer that to the government. Offer that to the people who are leaders over you in the world. Will they accept that? Why don't we think about the things we offer, from the smallest thing to the biggest thing? Is it the very best thing we offer unto the Lord our God? If you are, you know, for example, you are taking records and then you give that record in the house of God, is that how you offer that? Let's say, for example, you're an accountant and then you have to do this and do that. Can you give that kind of record to the bank? Will the bank accept that? Or will they terminate your appointment? Or maybe let's say you're offering, worship before the Lord. You're singing unto the Lord. And the kind of singer you sing, can you offer that in the concerts of the world? Can you offer that to all those ceremonies of the world? That's what the Lord is saying. And let's say you're offering, for example, teaching. You want to teach the Bible and you're teaching the people of God and you didn't prepare. Can you offer that in the schools in the world? Can you offer that in the college? Will they accept that in your hand? Let's say, for example, you're offering food in the house of God. And this is, you know, what you are serving the people of God. If you serve that in your canteen in the world, will you make any sales at all? That's what he's saying. He said, if you can not offer those things to the people of the world, to those who are fathers and masters and governors, how is it you think God will accept that from you? He's calling us to examine our service. He's calling us to examine our offering before the Lord. And he's saying that if the people of the world cannot get that from you, will not accept that from you, each year will not accept that from you. The best and not the worst. That's what we offer. The first and not the leftover. That's what we offer. The clean and not the unclean. Not the corrupt. That's what we offer. The pure and not the polluted. That's what we offer. The costly and not the cheap. That's what we offer. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 15. Deuteronomy chapter 15 and look at verse 21. And see the commandment the Lord has given. If you're offering anything to the Lord from the house fellowship to the time, district and then to the group, and anything you're offering to the Lord, you must make sure you offer the very best. You go over that thing again. You polish that thing. You make it the very best you're offering unto the Lord. And then let's look at chapter 15, verse 21. It says, and if, that's Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 21, what we offer to the Lord. It says, and if there be any blemish therein, as if it was lame or blind or have any ill blemish, thou shalt not sacrifice it unto the Lord thy God. You see that? Anything you are offering to the Lord, if it has any blemish at all, you cannot offer it. You must not offer it unto the Lord. It tells us in 1 Samuel chapter 2. That's the controversy God had with Eli. The controversy he had with the sons of Eli. What they were offering to the Lord was not the very best. And people now, they detested the sacrifice of the Lord just because of them. Those things had no value anymore. And those things did not have any acceptance in the presence of the Lord anymore. It says in chapter 2, verse 17, it says, wherefore, The sin of the young man was very great before the Lord, for men abhorred the offering of the Lord. Men abhorred, despised, detested the offering of the Lord. It wasn't special anymore. It wasn't acceptable anymore. It wasn't the very first anymore. It wasn't the very best anymore. And God said he did not want that kind of sacrifice. He wanted the people to show some love, some respect, and some honor for him. We're looking at Ezekiel chapter 22. Ezekiel chapter 22, and I'm reading from verse 26. Ezekiel chapter 22, and we're reading from verse 26. And those priests that were accepting, that they were encouraging the people of Israel to offer just anything, refuse, something defiled, something corrupt, something polluted, something contemptible unto the Lord. The priests were not demanding the very best for God. They were not demanding the very first for God. And they were justifying those children of Israel that it was all right to offer polluted bread and polluted, corruptible and contemptible things. In Ezekiel chapter 22, verse, reading from verse 26, a priest have violated my law and I profaned my holy things. They have put no difference between the holy and the profane. Neither have they showed difference between the clean and the unclean. And have hid their eyes from my Sabbath. It says, my Sabbath, that is, the holy day became like ordinary day. But everything became the same. And the offerings were polluted. And they were not acceptable in the sight of the Lord. Our princes in the midst thereof are like wolves ravening the prey. And to shed blood and to destroy the souls. To destroy souls. Destroy the souls of men. And that's why God now said he had no pleasure in all those offerings and sacrifices they were making. All that the Lord was saying is, I love you. Why don't you show some love back? And I'm blessing you. Why don't you bless my name? I want to magnify you like I magnified Joshua before the children of Israel. Why don't you magnify me? And why don't you give to me the honor and the glory that is due unto my name? Let's come back to Malachi. I'm reading here now from verse 10. Malachi chapter 1. We're reading from verse 10. Who is there even among you that would shut the doors for naught? Neither do ye kindle fire on mine altar for naught. There must be a purpose. When you read any service before the Lord, you ask yourself, any purpose in that? Any glory in that? Any joy in that? Any sacrifice in that? Have I given my best to the Lord? And the story is told of a particular man. He could swim. And then something happened. There was a boat that capsized. And many people were in the water in the river. And it was storming. And this person will dive into the river. And then he saved the first person. And then he dived back again and saved the second person. He went on like that, into the water, out of the water, into the water, out of the water, for about 17 times, and then rescued 17 people. And then himself, he was laying on the ground, on the floor at the shore, exhausted. They took him to the hospital.